Are you beginning the year with a limp? I feel like I am. And it's starting to look like the worship team is too. Wayne breaks his finger. so he got that happened like the week right before Christmas Eve and all the services there. So he can't play his bass at all. Now Russ has got some kind of virus or something like that. So he's coughing and hacking, and that adds to the fact that he can't get out of his house because of the steep hill with the ice on it and all. So Russ has challenges. We already had Mike, who's been sick all year long. I don't remember any time the last one of us saw Mike Christensen. And then to top it off, on Friday, Debbie and I got the privilege of spending 9 hours in the hacking emergency ward. Have you ever noticed how many sick people are at the emergency? So we got the privilege because I did something to my back. I believe it's the back. We're not even sure now. The doctor sent me down there. He said, well, maybe this is your, who knows? It could be one of your vital organs inside, and we've got to find out. So you need to go down there and do a test because we're closed and we can't do them all here. And so we got the privilege to spend 9 hours at St. B's. And at the end of that, I hurt more than when I got there. So I feel like I'm beginning the year with a limp. All I did was shovel a little bit of snow, and now the pain in the back is just, it's there all the time, and it's excruciating, especially if I sit in a car, or sit in worship, or sit anywhere. So I'm beginning the year with a limp. And frankly, I'm beginning to feel that we as a church are beginning the year a little bit with a limp. So we've had snow now on the weekends, the last 2 weekends, right? What did it do to our Christmas Eve services? And even to this morning, the attendance. We're kind of beginning the year with a limp as we face challenges. And we even have youth that say, well, it's boring there, Pastor Bill, so we're not going to come on Sunday. But they come to the youth group on Wednesday night when I lead. So I'm boring on Sunday, but I guess I'm not boring on Wednesday. There's just different challenges that we're facing, even as a ministry. Look at the number of people that have gotten sick in our congregation that are literally, Mike Christians, I already mentioned him as an example. Look, Russ, who's not here, but Rainey O'Neill. I mean, you start looking through the people, and then the people that have moved away from our church, literally moved off the mountain. Carol, I just read her Christmas card this morning. I mean, it's been kind of bizarre. I get the several messenger messages this week from Anna. Anna, who's moved up to Northern California, I believe it is, right? I might be wrong on that, but she moved, right? Her and the kids and her husband all moved away. And it's like, and she sent these messages, Pastor Bill, I miss you and Mrs. Debbie. She calls her Mrs. Debbie. I miss you and Mrs. Debbie, and I miss the church, and I haven't found a church. She's going to a large church up there right now, but they only have big Bible studies and big groups, and I don't feel close to anybody. I miss you guys. And that's like the fourth, fifth message that I've gotten. I miss you guys. I miss you guys. And we're beginning the year with a limp. There's challenges that we're facing as a church, as a ministry, personal lives. Fortunately, those of you who are here didn't start out this year that way, right? None of you had any challenges. Nobody had a tooth removed on Friday. Nobody's moving into a smaller house. Nobody just got off of chemotherapy this last year. I mean, none of you are facing any challenges, right? Life is simply a piece of cake. Well, this morning we're going to look at a man who is going to begin the rest of his life with a limp. And actually, this limp is a good thing for him. The man's name is Jacob. His story is told in Genesis 32. We probably have to back up a little bit because there's several chapters in Genesis that talk about Jacob and his experience. When he was born a twin. And his older brother Esau, as he was being born, Jacob was holding on to his heel. With that, they give him the name Jacob, which means supplanter. He's holding on to the heel of another in order to be born. And the interesting thing is this, as this occurs in Jacob's life, his parents are told that Jacob will actually be the one who gets the birthright, who actually gets privilege over Esau, the older brother. This is actually something that God has declared for Jacob. Now that's really important to take note of. Because while God has planned for this to happen, Jacob will go about all kinds of schemes to do it on his own. He is so insensitive that his brother comes home one day famished from having been hunting for food for the family. Esau's a hunter, deals with the animals. Jacob deals with plants. And he's kind of like the home guy. Well, and he's a great cook, great chef. And so Esau comes home literally famished, dying of hunger, and asks his brother for some food. And the manipulator, the supplanter, the guy holding on to the foot says, I'll be glad to give you some food. You just give me your birthright. I'm going to die anyways if I don't have something to eat. Sure, you can have my birthright. Now, did he really mean it? Probably not. Was he really dying? Who knows? But what we do know is Jacob was so insensitive that he didn't really care about his brother's need. He manipulated the moment for what he wanted. That was not God's intent. Life will go on, and it will come to the time when his dad Isaac's getting old. And his mom, who is kind of likes Jacob more than Esau anyways, comes to Jacob and says, Dad's getting old. He's about to give the blessing out to your brother. We need to do something about that. And they work up a scheme to lie to Isaac. See, Isaac can't see any longer. There's a little challenge even with hearing. And so they put wool on Jacob's arms because Esau is a very hairy guy. Jacob's not. So they put hair on him here and hair on him here and on, covering up so that if Isaac touches him, he'll say, oh, it is Esau. Sure doesn't sound like you, but it looks like, it feels like you. And so they do that. And not only that, but his mom works up this great meal. And she gives him the meal because what has happened is Esau has been sent out to prepare food for Isaac and to bring it back and to feed Isaac. And then after the meal, Isaac is going to bless Esau. So Jacob and mom work out this terrible plan, and they connive against dad. They go in, they take the food in, and start feeding. Oh, this is really delicious. This is wonderful. Thank you, Esau. And okay, I'm ready to bless you. And Isaac even kind of like, boy, you sure sound like Jacob. Come closer, my son. And he'll feel his arm. You know, okay, well, you feel like Esau. Sounds like Jacob's voice, but you feel like Esau. So he gives him the blessing, which means now he has the birthright, which means now he has the privilege of the privileges of the firstborn. He gets the greater inheritance and all that. Esau comes back with his prey, cooks his meal, brings it into dad, and says, well, Dad, here is the food I prepared for you. And Isaac realizes he's been duped. I don't have a blessing to give you. I've given it away already. No, Dad, I'm Esau. You can't give it away. No, I've done it already. Don't you have anything for me? And so Isaac will bless Esau to some extent, but not like what he did with Jacob. As you can imagine, Esau's just a bit upset. One good way to take care of this would be now to knock off Jacob. Jacob, knowing that Esau is upset, and his mom also realizing this, Jacob decides to leave. And Jacob will take off, go back to his mom's family, where he will then find a bride that he will marry. Only problem with that is Laban, the father-in-law, says there's two girls here, one Leah and one Rachel. Leah is the oldest, and on the wedding night, he sneaks Leah in instead of Rachel. I mean, they're all veiled up, so you can't really see. And she's so Leah goes to the wedding ceremony. Leah's in the bedroom, and suddenly Jacob realizes he's been duped. He doesn't have the bride that he wanted. Oh, and he had to work 7 years to earn Leah, which he thought was Rachel. So he goes back to Laban. Now he's got to work 7 more years in order to earn the bride that he really wanted. He has 10 sons to Leah. He has 1 son at this point in time to Rachel. And he finally decides he's actually, and there's been lots more pieces to this story where Laban tries to trick him, tries to rip him off, and he has to go for the spotted animals and the black animals and different things like that until finally he has great herds and all, and he's ready to leave, and he sneaks out at night with all of his kids, with his brides, with all of their servants, with all their animals and all, and he sneaks away, and Laban finds out about it and comes looking for him. And they finally end their relationship, and he heads on. And now he's heading back to the promised land to see mom, dad, and his brother. It's been over 20 years. And you remember what happened? 20 years ago, he left because Esau wanted his neck. What does he know has changed in the meantime? Nothing. He's had no contact, no communication. So as far as he's concerned, he's heading back to the same guy, same situation, where his brother wants him dead. He starts traveling across the land. He gets really close, comes up to the Jabbok River, and he's actually divided. See, he's kind of a schemer here again. He stops, he prays to God, he says, okay, God, protect me. And okay, thank you, God. And then he divides up his livestock and everything into 2 groups so that if when Esau meets the first group, he fights and kills them, then the second group can get away. In addition to that, not only has he sent all these groups, and they've been all told, keep telling him, hey, these are gifts from your brother, and he's coming. And he, by the way, he's back there. He's right behind us. And the hope that Jacob has is that he'll appease his brother so that he'll give him all this stuff, and finally he'll decide he'll wear out and not kill him. He takes his 2 brides, their few servants and his sons, takes them across the Jabbok River, and then he goes back on the other side and he spends the night. And that's where we pick up the story in Genesis 32. Now I'm going to begin reading at verse 19. He also instructed the second, the third, and all the others who followed the herds. You are to say the same thing to Esau when you meet him. And be sure to say, your servant Jacob is coming behind us. For he thought, I will pacify him with these gifts I am sending on ahead. Later when I see him, perhaps he will receive me. So Jacob's gifts went on ahead of him, but he himself spent the night in the camp. That night, Jacob got up and took his 2 wives, his 2 maidservants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, let me go, for it is daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. The man asked him, what is your name? Jacob, he answered. Then the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome. Jacob said, please tell me your name. But he replied, why do you ask my name? Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, it is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared. The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. He had tricked everyone he knew. He was a cheater. He didn't trust God. He tried to do things on himself. He was much like the man that you saw in the video. Self, with a capital S-E-L-F, confident. Confident in his own abilities, but not trusting God. I have a question. When you pray, do you expect God to answer? When you come to God, do you expect Him to respond to you? Sometimes our prayers are just give me prayers, right? Give me this, God. Give me a new car. Give me a new house. Give me a new family. They're give me prayers. Give me a job. Give me money. Give me home. Give me health. Whatever, give me food. But they're give me prayers. But do you pray and actually seek God out, ask Him for counsel, and then expect Him to respond? Even the give me prayers, do you expect Him to give what you ask for? You're praying for someone else, some other need, something personal in your life. Do you really expect God to respond? Because our problem with Jacob, and somewhat our own problem, is Jacob did not expect a response. He stops before the Jabbok. He stops before he meets with his brother. He's afraid of what's going to happen, terrified. In fact, what I didn't read to you was he also got news that his brother was coming. Yay! We're going to have a reunion! And he's bringing 400 armed men with him! Bummer! This is not going to look good! It's not going to end well! Because what he's expecting is Esau is coming armed with 400 guys to take him and his family out. Not for dinner, but to kill them. When you pray, do you expect an answer? In Genesis, it says that Jacob prayed. Praise to God. God, okay. God, I'm afraid now. It's interesting. Now he comes to God for help. After he's done all these other things and he's on his way back. Oh, and he's even had some angels appear to him and tell him he's supposed to go do this. But they didn't tell him what would happen. And so now he's praying, God, I'm afraid. Just like in the, I'm scared. Did you hear it at the end there? That's really where that man was. All of his self-confidence. No, there was really fear there about his own ability. And Jacob's praying, okay, God, help me out here! And then Jacob works up his own plan. The supplanter can't stop, can he? And so he works up this plan, organized all these people, all of his livestock, all of his servants, including his brides and his sons. And notice, by the way, who's last? Rachel and Joseph are last. Even Leah gets sacrificed ahead of the one that really matters to him. So he's put everything out there in order of what really matters to him. And the last, the ones that really matter the most, Joseph and Rachel, he's kept them. And then it's him. Now, don't you think if he really was concerned about his livestock, his sons, his wives, why didn't the supplanter lead the way? Because that would have taken confidence in God and not fear of how he's going to handle this day. Jacob doesn't even wait for God's direction. Divides things up, sets out about his plan, and then heads back over the Jabbok, the last guy. I'm going to be the last one killed. Well, that's really courageous of you, isn't it, Jacob? And while he's there, the word says that a man wrestled with him. And it's really key to understand that. A man wrestled with him, not he wrestled with a man. And from what we understand from the text, the man is God himself, or at least an angel of the Lord who's come to him. Well, many commentators actually say it was Jesus himself who came to wrestle with Jacob that night. By the way, just thinking about that for a moment. If God had come, or even an angel had wrestled with Jacob, don't you think they could have won? So did God really need to fight with him all night long? No. Couldn't he have zapped him early, put him on the ground, pinned him right away, right? You want to wrestle with me? Okay. I mean, it's not fair at all, is it? To wrestle against God? But see, God had come to wrestle with Jacob because Jacob had not come to the place where he was yet willing to come to God for God's help. C.K. McIntosh, in his notes on the Pentateuch, says, though Jacob asked God to deliver him from his brother Esau, he evidently was not satisfied with that. And therefore, he had tried to appease him with a present. Thus, his confidence was in the present and not entirely in God. He goes on, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. It is often hard to detect what is the real ground of the heart's confidence. We imagine or would fain persuade ourselves that we are leaning upon God when we are in reality leaning upon some scheme of our own devising, which is what Jacob's problem was. He thinks, if I give him this present, did you see it? Right there in Genesis 32. If I give Jacob this present, then I'll be okay. Right. McIntosh goes on, we must be really brought to the end of everything with which self has ought to do. For until then, God cannot show himself. But we can never get to the end of our plans until we have been brought to the end of ourselves. Under the plausible and apparently pious formula of using means, we really cloak the positive infidelity of our poor, deceitful hearts. We think we are looking to God to bless our means, while in reality, we are shutting him out by leaning on the means instead of leaning on him. It's interesting, one of the other passages that talks about the renaming of Jacob is Hosea chapter 12. And in chapter 13, Hosea says this, it is your destruction, O Israel, that you are against me, against your help. O Israel, thou hast destroyed thyself, but in me is thine help. We don't win until we lose. God wrestles with Jacob all night long. Finally, when he sees that Jacob's still not giving in, he finally touches him right there on the hip. And he gets this limp and pain. And he can't stand up without hanging on to the man. See, the problem for Jacob is he's been wrestling with God all his life. He's been wrestling with his own wishes and his own priorities, if you will, his own schemes, his own methods. He's been living life totally on his own with the false appearance that somehow he's trusting God when he's not. He hasn't really sought God's assistance. He's that self-made, self-confident man who's going through this on his own. A tough guy. However, tonight, finally, worn out, limping, alone, afraid, not sure of what morning brings, he hangs on to this one who's been wrestling with him. And he says, I won't let go until you bless me. And God gives him a brand new name. God takes this man who's been the conniver, the supplanter, the cheater, and he says, I'm going to give you a brand new name. And there's some interesting dynamics in that new name. He says, I'm going to give you a name called Israel. This is the blessing he gets. I'm changing your name. Oh, good. That way Esau won't find me. I'm somebody else. He won't recognize me anywhere 20 years later now. So I'll just say, I'm Israel. I'm not Jacob. He was over there somewhere. No, he says, I'm going to give you a new name. And the name has two meanings to it. One is wrestles with God. Now, that's an interesting term, isn't it, when you think about Israel? For centuries, Israel has been one that wrestles with God. Wrestles with whether they're going to be people of faith or not, whether they're going to follow him. Even when Christ comes, Israel is so committed to the law and to the rules and to the stuff and to the legalism that they can't even see that the Messiah is right there in front of them. And many of them will totally ignore him and be a part of his actual crucifixion and death on that cross. One who wrestles with God and wins. And the other meaning behind that term is the one who wrestles with God and wins is a prince. And Jacob, God saying to Jacob, Jacob, you've been the supplanter, you've been the cheater, you've been the conniver, but Jacob, you're now going to become my prince. I now am going to accomplish in your life what I promised before you were born. And the good news is Jacob is finally at the place where he's ready to trust God. Where he's literally, get it, do you see the picture? Where he's literally leaning on God. We don't win, folks, until we lose. And we have to be broken sometimes to be blessed. You've all heard it, that most people who have a serious drug addiction, alcoholism or something like that, generally don't get free of that addiction until they reach a point where they break. It's like they have to hit bottom. I actually went to a course with psychologists and psychiatrists, and they were talking about how to have an intervention, how to guide a family to do an intervention so that a wife may come in and with the children and with the boss and with other friends all will gather together and they'll all unite to talk to this one person and say, look, you're an alcoholic or you're an addict and you need to change and we have a plan for you. You can go into this treatment and all and you can fight it if you want to and we'll stand with you. But if not, you're not allowed at home any longer. You're going to lose your job from the employer. And everyone will stand together and say, we're united in this. And what are they all trying to do? What the hope was is that this is a forced breaking of the person. So they don't really have to hit bottom, 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 lose the whole family, lose everyone they love, lose everything they have, be out on the street with nothing, and then say, okay, I got nothing at all, so God help me. They're trying to actually interrupt and give them the breaking at that point. Limping, broken, afraid, knowing there's really nothing now between him and Esau. He grabs a hold of the one who can bless him. The cheater finally seeks the blessings of the one and the only one who can help him. The deceiver becomes honest with himself about his weakness and honest with God about his need to lean on him. A young lady, she says, her name is Zek. She's 30 years old. She writes a blog on, and in the blog she says, I don't know a lot about the Bible. She says, I'm not a theologian. I haven't trained in seminary. But she says, I'm trying to learn more about how to follow him. And she writes, about Jacob. She says, are you ready to let go of your own ways and ideas and follow God's instead? Are you ready? For daybreak is coming. At the moment when Jacob's hip was hurt, I would like to think that he suddenly understood that he was weaker. When he understood that daybreak was approaching and Esau was coming, and faced with the fact that he was actually a weak person, he made his decision and he clung on to God. We have to break sometimes before we can be blessed. And we may need to limp in order to lean. When do you lean on somebody else when you can't go it alone? When do you need that crutch, if you will? And that may sound like, oh, I don't need a crutch. No, that's what Jacob thought too. When do you need that crutch to hold you up when you can't walk without it? When we're limping, we need to lean. How did Proverbs say it? We need to lean on His understanding and not our own. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. When things are difficult, when things are troubling, and frankly, when things are great, when we're most distracted, when we think we can do it by ourselves, that's when we need to lean on God Himself. See, my concern, and I think God's, is we come to God too self-confident. Too self-confident. And we need to learn, we need to be broken in order to be blessed. Have you sought God's blessing? No, I mean really sought God's blessing, really taken your needs to Him in prayer. Or have you just taken the prayer request to Him and then gone out and made up your own plan with how you're going to deal with life? Are you held back by past sin? Jacob, wouldn't you like that? To be known as the cheater. And you, every time you walk up, kind of like the person who had the leprosy. You walk up and they say, oh, hi, cheater. What a nice name. Hi, supplanter. Hi, deceiver. You're a great guy. I just look forward to doing business with you. Right? But isn't that some of what we carry with us? Oh, the people around us may not know what we're carrying, but inside, are we carrying sin that's still harming us? Are we looking at ourselves with a label that we carry? That God says, I want to change your name. I want to bless you, but you've got to lean on me to let me bless you. You've got to allow me to give you the new name. See, our problem is too often we're striving to succeed on our own without actually seeking God. And the result is, we wrestle with God. But God is coming and is wrestling with us in order to get us to lean on Him. And I guess, isn't that part of the message of communion? Can any one of you get to heaven without Jesus? Oh, the world's trying. And the world thinks we can. We can just do it by our behavior, right? Or because we look nice, or we go to a Baptist church. Doesn't that get us in? No. You can't get into heaven without Jesus Christ. And communion reminds us that we need to lean on Christ. And not just when things are rough, but at all times. Jacob will continue the rest of his life with a limp. That's what we believe. He'll continue on with a limp. But I got a feeling that Jacob didn't go through, oh, I'm hurting, oh, back in that day that God wrestled me, that mean God that I have, you know, and he was suffering. I'm still hurting because of what God did to me. No, I think Jacob went through life like this. Yes, I've got a limp. I've got a limp from the day that God touched me. The day that God blessed me, the day that God changed my name, the day that God forgave me for the things that I'd done in the past, I've got a limp that I carry with me. And it reminds me every single day that I'm trusting God and not myself. Praise God, I've got a limp. What are you? See, communion says we come to him and we celebrate even that we've got the limp, because God's making us into something new. We're limping into 2017. I sure don't want ice and snow every Saturday night for the next month or two. But aren't we limping? Too many people right here believe there's nobody that they know that they can share Jesus Christ with and help them come to life. Too many of God's people sit and wait or think that they don't know how to talk, so they don't share Jesus Christ. And we're limping into this community. Well, let's let our limp be the reminder that God is blessing us and that we're leaning on him, that we're trusting him. And so let's take communion today as a celebration of the fact that we've been given a new name, and that new name is forgiven, set free, new child of the King, servant, anointed with the Holy Spirit, ready and prepared to do his will. Amen? Amen. God. I'd rather not hurt like this the rest of my life. But if the pain that I feel keeps me standing before you or crying on the floor at your face, then don't let it go away. If the pain that we feel, the limp that we have right now, causes us to lean on you, if it reminds us that like Paul, that we have a thorn in the flesh that we'd love and prayed that it would go away, but it hasn't. If it's what we need to be reminding us that you are with us and that we can trust you and that you're leading us to a better place, Lord, whatever it is that you need to do in us, if that pain and that limp is going to help it, then God, I pray for more limps. And I pray that we as a people would limp into 2017 leaning on you and not ourselves. Now, God, forgive us, cleanse us. Please, God, we're not going to let go until you bless us. In Jesus' name.